sometimes feel truly alone in this world. We had a service, or a nice service last week, this time last week, in paying honor and remembering our servicemen and women who give all of their, or they give their all, I should say, to their country and for us. We even recognize people across all the world who do the same for their country and their people. As we know, we're not the only country that has a military, and we're not the only country that has people who serve their military with dignity and with honor. Right now I'm particularly thinking of France, and the people who are now being called to serve and give their all for their country in the wake of what happened there. So we came here and we honored those people. We pointed out that our vet service is a great example of what it means to be committed to others. It's committed to selfless servant leadership. And then 2 days later, what happened? 2 days later, we turn on our television screen and we see unfolding before our eyes ISIS pulling off the unthinkable. It shouldn't be unthinkable anymore, which is sad to say, but it is the unthinkable. That multiple simultaneous terror attacks in various locations around the city of Paris, France. How could something like that happen? It's unfathomable. It's unfathom. That word's not going to come out. Unfathomable. There we go. Unthinkable. Even today, to think back to September 11th, and to think that people can hijack planes, not one, not two, but three planes, and direct them at different buildings and attack our country in such a way, we would have, before that, never have thought that possible. Were there four planes? One, two.
Towers, Pentagon, and two.
Oh, the Pentagon, right. Yes, four planes, right. Right, the field, I forgot the field. Four planes, and that they could hit different locations relatively around the same time is unthinkable. Who would ever think that people, let alone terrorists, could pull something like that off? I mean, the idea of a terrorist hijacking a plane isn't unthinkable, but actually taking control of the plane and flying the entire plane and its passengers into buildings to have that kind of navigation skill, and then to find out that these were people that were in our country training to become pilots using our pilot gear and using our technology to learn these things, it's unthinkable. And yet here we have, in France, the same thing. People coming in, living, some of them are citizens from what it sounds like, of France, and learning and joining sides with ISIS and learning how to do these attacks, even maybe some being trained by ISIS to come in and do these attacks. And then you have on one night restaurant shootings, explosions outside of a soccer field, explosions inside of a concert hall. It's unthinkable. The police, I'm sure, in the moment were like, oh my goodness, what do we do? Like, where do we go? What next? To think that these things were all happening at once. And all I could think to myself was, here we go again. Now, I don't know about you, but when I watched the news unfold in France, I felt my soul burdened. I instantly remembered, and this is perhaps, what year were you born, Miranda?
2001.
Oh, this is the year you were born. What month?
July.
July, so you were alive.
Not
that you would remember, but you were alive, yes. I vividly remember where I was that day. I remember the confusion, the shock, the anxiety, the sadness, the despair, the anger that I had in that moment. And I'm watching this unfold in France and immediately feeling what they're feeling because I've been through it before. When will this kind of stuff end? When will our men and women be freed from having to live in violence and harm's way in order to protect others? When is God going to just come and put an end to all of this. I think that's the heart and soul of the book of Revelation. When, God? When? That last question, perhaps more than others, can really lead us to feel so alone in this world. And I think the most driving question in that feeling of loneliness, of feeling alone, is this. Where is God in all of this? We go to worship services, we lift our hands and sing about how great our God is, how wonderful our God is, how powerful our God is, how king-like and conquering-like our God is. And yet, we turn on the news and we see our world literally up in flames, people blowing themselves up along with other people, people shooting other people in cold blood. We turn on another news station, we hear about kids being kidnapped and pastors' wives being shot in their homes, and we think to ourselves, where is God? Where is this great and wonderful God? Where is this Jesus Christ, that whose name every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord? Our scripture tonight points us to that answer. We often live our lives in paralysis, waiting for some supergirl, because I'm into Supergirl right now, some supergirl to come flying in and save the day. And when that doesn't happen, we point to the sky, we clench our fists, and we shake it and go, why, God, why aren't you coming to save us? But the author of Hebrews points us to an inconvenient truth. God has given us Jesus Christ, who removed sin once and for all. And when you hear that, you may be scratching your head, wait a second, okay, so Jesus came, he died on the cross, he removed sin once and for all, and yet, Pastor Todd, I'm turning on the TV and people are blowing themselves up. They're killing, they're maiming, they're stealing, they're raping. What do you mean to remove sin once and for all? It's very evident that sin and evil are still here. But it's not that God preemptively removed sin, but he presented the possibility of sin being removed. And now, God waits for us. God is waiting for us to respond to Jesus' sacrifice. You see, if God forced us to love him, it wouldn't be love. If I said, granted, you will love me, and if you don't love me, there's going to be some consequences that you're going to really, really, really come to regret, and you're going to wish you loved me to begin with. Are you loving me yet? You can't do it. You can't force somebody to love you. That's a part of free will. Now, I don't use free will as an excuse for the evil in the world. Some people try to do that. But it is a matter of fact that we live in a world where people are free to make the choices they do. And as a result, we reap the rewards or suffer the consequences of those choices. God is waiting for us to respond to Jesus' sacrifice. Those who accept it, according to the author of Hebrews, those who accept it are being perfected in Christ, are being made holy, and are being recreated in Christ. In other words, to put this into words that are more modern and more easy to understand in our context, in other words, we are the ones that God is calling to do the work of God in the world. We are the ones, if we accept Jesus Christ, if we accept the forgiveness of our sins, that will come into us, that will transform us, and in the end, we will be the ones that represent God in the world and transform the world. Instead of waiting for Supergirl to come in and fly on and conquer every monster that comes in, and I don't know if you've watched the show or not, or if you ever watched any superhero movie, Superman or any of them, the hero has a hard time keeping up with all the villains, you know? Like, if there's one villain after the next, you can't be in 500 places at the same time. Even if you're the Flash, you can't do it, right? You can only be so many places at once. People are always waiting for the hero to come in and save the day. But God's saying, you're the hero. You are. If you will only accept my son and follow his lead. Since our creation, we have had divine accessibility to God. We are not alone. God is not somewhere out there abandoning us to our own fate. God is intimately involved with humanity, so intimate that God became a human being and walked among us and gave up being God for a time and suffered the consequences of that, suffered the poverty, suffered the humility, suffered the humiliation, suffered the torture and the death. And what's more, we were created in God's image and have always had that divine spark within us. We don't even have to look to the door to find God. We just have to look within. It doesn't get much more intimate or close than that. Yet people have fallen short of grasping that. And instead of displaying that image and living lives of justice, mercy, compassion, and love, we end up living lives of division and hatred and enmity and strife and bitterness. The list goes on and on and on. We have created, instead of living the lives of justice and mercy and compassion and love, we've created rituals around invoking God to come and do it for us. We'll just go on living as we do. God, come save the day, please. We won't change. We won't change. We won't do anything but lift our hands and wait for the God of the sky to come down, swoop in, and save us from ourselves. So God sent Jesus Christ as a living embodiment of God to show us the way and to be a living sacrifice for us so that we might be reawakened to the divine presence within us. Jesus came to show us, not that he was some great magician who could do some really cool things and then to disappear and say, sorry, I'll be back some other day. Jesus came to show us that the very things he was doing, we could do even greater things if we only had faith in God and followed his lead. Question for us is, will we utilize our divine accessibility? Will we invite God into our hearts and allow God to take over? Or will we continue to isolate ourselves from God and remain stuck in wondering why God isn't showing up? It's kind of funny. Just picture this, right? Picture going into a dark closet, shutting out the rest of the people in the room outside, and wondering why no one is with you. This is the way we live our lives. It's not that God isn't with us, it's that we're closing God out of us. So which is it? Will we continue to isolate ourselves from God? Or will we invite God into our hearts, allow God to take over our lives and live in us and through us? The choice has always been ours, just like it's the choice of the terrorists to go destroy people and to destroy life, just like it's the choice of robbers to go into houses and steal things that don't belong to them. Just like it's our choice to be angry at someone perpetually or to forgive them. It has always been our choice. And God is waiting for our response. Amen. Gracious and loving God, we are certainly challenged by the things we see going on in our world. Not only challenged because it's painful to see people suffer, but challenged because we know that you have called us to do more than perhaps we are doing to make this world a better place. And Lord, that's a process. But we ask that you work in us and through us, and even in spite of us, to keep us growing in that process, so that we may, by each day and each moment, look more and more like you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.